all, it's going to be either this side or that side. I think they told us it's going to be this side. But I can't see a vacant space, that's the only thing. Can't read it, can you? Compston, that's it. That's it, Compston.
Do you want to start with your name and occupation, please?
Name, Joshua Compston, Director of Faction Nonsense, aka FN Holdings.
Remember at the funeral, you sort of, all these faces, 600 people, and every single one of us feeling we knew Josh. We had the, you know.
The one hand up the hand.
We knew more about him than anyone else. We could see it in everyone's face. So I'm sure you've already found that. Incredible quality he must have had to make 600 people at the age of 25 come to a funeral, each one of them feeling they knew him.
Joshua was 5'10", blonde, but not one of those hairy blondes, not one of those bald blondes with big, thick, bushy hair on his chest. And his chest was thick and heavy and well set.
Joshua was a kind of 19th century romantic with very strong Machiavellian qualities and a paranoid lust for power.
An exceptional person. He had an ability to see things in a way that other people didn't see things. And that influenced everything.
It was a tremendous enthusiast. Very, very amusing. A tremendous sense of fun. Mm. And, what else?
Irritating, frustrating, romantic.
I thought he was an arrogant little shit.
I didn't really quite comprehend what the hell was going on. You know, he's going to build new cities. Is he a, you know, a fascist? What? Who the hell is he? I hadn't really have a proper grasp on him, apart from I knew that I liked him a lot.
I remember seeing like an image of Josh standing from those windows with his arms folded because he'd like fell out, I think, after a drunken party one night. He fell out the window and broke his arm. I guess he sort of wanted to make things happen outside of the gallery.
He's the kind of person that I think if we stayed with him too long, we'd have ended up kicking the hell out of each other, really. I think we were about to like probably have a good fight.
What, did I know Joshua Compston? Lovely Joshua Compston in his white safari suit and his golden ringlets and his well-spoken voice. Did I know Joshua? No, not really. Anyway, nice boat. This is for Joshua.
He was very important to a particular time of British art, particularly when it was very, in the early 90s, when it was very, it was not hardly formalised. It hadn't become the sort of more established thing that it has done now. And he was very much part of that. Joshua's, I mean, all Joshua's press releases and cards, they always used to do with text, and he worked closely with Tom Shaw. So Tom Shaw and Joshua and myself got together, we did this project. Iron's Flowers is a publication by 15 artists, is 15 texts works by 15 artists that was commissioned by Joshua. The brief to the artists was to make a work out of text, and they could do that any way they liked, but we wanted to print that letterpress, so the brief was really quite open. There also was a restriction on size. We wanted it to get it into a portfolio. This is by Tracey, Emin. This is by Angus Fairhurst. Joshua would have preferred more text, but Angus got away with just "It's okay." This is by Don Brown. This is Gary Hume's first print. It's called Appy. Well, as a curator, what was it? He was very independent because he was never able to create anything in a established art space. I mean, he never quite had that opportunity, apart from when he was at the Coffield. Beyond that, he was always working with his gallery at Factual Nonsense. And he created some extraordinary exhibitions there.
He had certain particular ideas about art that never quite changed throughout the years. Like many practicing artists nowadays, he was very much interested in a period of art that ran from about, I'd say, 1905 to 1930, that particularly took in Dada and Surrealism. And when he came to form the idea behind Factual Nonsense and many of his shows, he relied on that fertile period.
What we're about to see here is a recreation, especially for the event, the Hanging Picnic. A seminal sort of performance agitprop piece by one of my favourite painters, Gary Hume.
Well, I think we should muck about.
Does that look all right, Josh, that one?
Yeah, it looks cool.
You've got to get them the right way up, otherwise it just doesn't look good.
Yeah. It was just really relief to have someone who said they weren't an artist, who you could go to as an artist and jump on his bandwagon and just move along a little bit and then get off it and go back onto your own little homestead. The worst thing about him being gone is that there's nowhere to go for him, for the likes of me. So if I want to do something which is sort of like out of myself, there's no one who does it, who can supply the out-of-myself world. And Joshua was sort of like great at supplying that, so he could supply it for quite a lot of people. Well, Joshua was the driving idea behind the Fate Worse Than Death, and that was to make this area the centre of culture of Europe, which, if you read the papers, it is. You know, 5 years later, whatever it is, 8 years later. And it was just a glorious little anarchic day out.
This is it, isn't it?
They've created a monument to work of art I did at the Hanging Picnic.
It was one of Joshua's nutty events, wasn't it? I mean, the Hanging Picnic was in this area, arena. It's got this perfect fence around it and hang great works of art along the railings.
Mm-hmm.
I guess here I managed to achieve a kind of coherency, intimacy, and kind of really warm sexiness as an event within contemporary culture that makes sense and really does bring all different sections of the population together.
He was a very real person, Josh. You know, I mean, he was like me in as much as he was in for cutting the crap and the nonsense, and he just, you know, he used to charge through, and I loved him for that. He just didn't really, you know, I think he really cared for the artists, and in my view, I'm not sure how many people really care for the artists. They're in for, you know, it's about the business, about pound shillings and pence, and Josh was not about that. He was, I think, over and above his genius, really. I think he was a tremendously sensitive and real person. And I think he's rather like me in a way. It's not about art just for the art world. It's art for all people all the time.
I don't know, there's some amazing myth been created around Joshua after his death that one wonders whether it existed in the first place. I don't know, it's like something becomes like immortal, or I don't know. It's just some huge myth that whether or not it happened, whether or not it was true or not, who knows?
Oh, we were lovers. He was great fun to be with, and I think his company, Factual Nonsense, was very independent in the way of promoting art. He was always thinking big. For example, we were walking from some party, very like young and happy and very drunk, and I would ask Josh what he are going to do. And he would say, I'm going to collect skyscrapers. First time I met him at the Colony Room in Soho. He walked straight in his white suit, kind of military. I think he looked like, wow, like a star.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, Josh. How are you? All right?
You okay?
Do you
want
to drink?
Michael, yeah, gin and tonic.
He tended to bring his own sort of gang in, really. I felt he felt he sort of made a discovery with the Colony Room, and so he wanted to bring as many of his friends up as possible. And at one point, he decided that he should have a Colony Room membership drive. But he didn't bother telling us about it. And suddenly, there are all these people turning up at the door going, "We're part of Josh Compston's membership drive for the Colony Room." Fuck off, man. Next time I saw it, I said, "Josh, what the fuck are you doing? If you're doing a membership drive, you could at least consult me first as to whether I want the membership drive done."
How's the preparation going?
It's going cool. Got some good sponsors.
Yeah. I got an invite. What is this picnic?
What happens as in Hoxton Square, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
We're kind of manipulating the social real.
Right.
To create a kind of grand, sort of champêtre, kind of feasting. So the idea is one's kind of curating people as much as curating the art.
Well, the real reason why Joshua gave up being an artist was because he craved power. And to actually get onto a level of power that he wished to seek, he would have had to have been an artist of the calibre of Picasso.
Who chose the artist? So is it...
I chose the artist, and some were recommended by various people. Mainly, I chose them.
Are you Joshua?
Yeah.
I'm Joshua Compston.
Right.
This piece here is like extremely beautiful, like the way it's like very well made, almost like kind of William Morris Crofton's like ethic. How involved are you with this work? Do you see it as like kind of observational, illustrational?
Yeah, it's like cool. It's hot. But, like, how is it dealing with kitsch? It seems very kind of
quite dangerously close to, or perhaps I'm completely wrong.
He wanted to have a huge global company which employed artists to make sort of teacups and stuff like that. I remember I had a friend who came over once from America who was selling Keith Haring china sets. And that was the kind of thing that Joshua was obsessed with. He thought, right, it's fantastic. You know, we'll do this with death instead. You know, I'll commission you to design a coffin and Gary Hume and whoever else. And then we'll sell it. You know, we'll do something for death. He was incredibly ambitious. I mean, he wanted to be rich, Joshua. He didn't want to be a poet, sort of eating cheese with artists or something. He wanted to be a tyrant and a sort of king or an emperor or something, you know. That's what he wanted. But he was a bit of he was slightly neurotic. Sort of 24-year-old kid with dreams the size of your imagination, really.
Towards the end, he was mostly interested in power. I don't actually think if Joshua were alive today, he wouldn't necessarily be practicing in the art world. I think he would have moved on to a level of the media or something. It was quite interesting that the day after he died, there was an article printed in the Sunday Times about how he had set up this thing to cure people of watching soap operas and things, which the relevance of that to art, I don't know.
Now, for most of us, watching soap operas is a pastime, it's fun, but for some people it is a problem, and there is a new group that's set up to counsel soap addicts. OK, and with me today are Joshua Compston and James McNamara. Welcome to Big Breakfast. Thanks. Now, first of all, Joshua, you are from the Jack Duckworth Memorial Clinic, is the name. Can you tell us a bit about how this started?
We started because friends of his in the Social Security office were constantly talking about soap operas as if those people on those operas were their real friends.
And it's actually called the Jack Duckworth Memorial Clinic. It is very serious.
Very serious.
And Jack Duckworth's not even dead.
But he may as well be then.
He was quite a difficult birth, and he came into the world angry and screaming. This was, and we lived in Putney at the time, and he screamed non-stop to the point that I had to actually employ somebody to take him off my hands one day a week just to walk him round Putney, endlessly walking, because that was the only way he kept quiet. He was digging a hole on the beach here at the Thames, and a good friend and neighbour came along and said, "Hello, Josh, what are you digging for? You digging for Australia, going to find Australia?" He said, "No, I'm looking for hell." And he was only 5 at the time. He, all his life, he questioned living and the whole concept of death.
I don't think we quite appreciated quite how seminal he was when he was alive. But then I think in families, I think that's fair enough. I mean, I think families' job is to say, look, shut up, Josh, you're being a bore. Now, for goodness sake, you know, will you go and make me a cup of tea or go and get another drink?
He struggled because he didn't have... He had more vision than money.
That's right, and Peter Blake once said, who was very good to him, Peter once said, you know, he reminds me of Richard Branson, I think Peter knew, but didn't know, and said, you know, he's either going to end up a Branson or dead.
He was extraordinarily loyal, wasn't he?
Yeah.
And, I mean, when we got married, and I, in a way, took you away from him, his great friend, he would come round and visit us. Mm. He was there the night we got back from our honeymoon.
We came back from our honeymoon very, very tired, and there was this darling little boy of 13 on the doorstep at 11 o'clock at night with some rather wilting flowers. I mean,
he came and stayed the night and stayed with us.
Oh.
A very, very loyal friend.
Yes, yes he was.
Who's that? Is it someone?
It's Joshua getting out the car, isn't it? That check coat. We see him all the time.
Now
he turned around.
Yeah.
Oh shit, no, it wasn't.
Nothing like her.
Hiya, fan.
His space was really him, you know. He lived and sort of worked there. You'd have parties there, you'd sort of, everything sort of revolved around factual nonsense as a space and as him. The sort of two were hand in hand, really. I've forgotten the question. It's so funny to sort of kind of recollect as well, because you go through phases where so many strong images of him come back, because he was such a sort of strong presence. And you know, and also remembering going round there and sort of waking him up, and he'd, you know, sort of scurry down from his platform, which is where he slept. And then you go through, I went through a really strange thing after he died in the funeral, which is, you know, sort of thinking that you see him somewhere, because you'd always see him sort of everywhere. In the most peculiar of places, he'd crop up. And you'd always get that feeling, oh, no, it's not, you know, it was very odd afterwards. And he was something to everyone, but in his own sort of special way.
I wanted to talk to you about my piece. I'm so excited about it.
He really created a buzz. And if it wasn't within his own, you know, factual nonsense space, he brought it into a different arena. And it was always something that got lots of artists and lots of people outside the art world quite excited about. So we invited lots of different artists to hang. Gosh, that was very strange. There's somebody walking across the road with blonde hair and glasses, and it looked a little bit like...
People recreate things, and you have to remember about Joshua too that he was so enthusiastic as a person and so muddled as to what he was trying to do that he would take on ideas in the middle of a conversation that he was having with somebody, which is why everybody feels that they have this amazing relationship with him. Because if he was talking to you, you'd be telling him about the films you're making and the stuff you're doing and all the rest of it, and suddenly, bang, out of the corner of his head, he'd be like, Liz! You know, we've got to make a film about, you know, I don't know, collecting skyscrapers.
Yeah, I'll say at the beginning, this is my friend Joshua, and then you can just, like, cut where you want. Okay, this book is called Kiss Me, Cover My Body in Love, Always Glad to See You, and it's from my friend Joshua. I finished my drink, and I said, well, I've got to go now. You know, things to do. I passed the off-licence. Voice from inside my head said, don't drink. Tracey, rest, sleep, be good to yourself. So I picked up a bottle of orange Gina. The problem with Joshua, you could never tell when he meant it and when he didn't. He was so passionate. But I think if he was around now, he'd be so much older and be doing so well, you'd absolutely know exactly what he meant. I think he's a bit of a control freak and stuff like that. Then I was sleeping. And there, out of the darkness, came Joshua. He was back, hovering above me, smiling, laughing, pointing down at me. His shirt was open, white. His chest was bare. And I was laughing, with my hand raised, pointing back. I shouted, Incubus. He shouted, Suscubus. Suscubus. As my eyes opened, I could still hear him laughing. But he had disappeared. He'd become light. My eyes closed and I slept. Irritating. No, it's true. Irritating. Oh, he had to do it because it was for Joshua. Yep, girl. Because Joshua from the outside asked me to do this thing. I've got to do it. I've got to do it. It's like now. I'm irritated. I don't need this right now. But it's for Joshua. Exactly the kind of thing. Exactly perfect. So even though he's dead, it's exactly the same situation. I do not need this right now. You can see I don't. But it's for Joshua, so that's how it goes. It was exactly the same when it was alive. I jumped out of bed and smiling, I said to myself, dear God, just don't ever, no, don't ever let me actually have changed it in over years. Dear God, only ever let me give birth. Dear God, only let me ever give me birth to my dreams. It's such a hard thing to say, actually. It's changed since Sasha's died, it's changed. I want more than dreams, actually. so.
I mean, the art world is two things, isn't it? There's relationships with artists and reasons why people do it, why people bother making art. And then there's people who make money out of people who bother making art. And Joshua hadn't really worked out where he stood as far as that was concerned, as a result of which nobody else really knew what they could do with him, because most of the people he was talking to were trying to make money out of art, and they didn't want to get involved with him because everything he touched turned to stone, financially, basically.
I was also madly busy. He was also madly busy. I wasn't really really aware if he wasn't getting that support. I don't know. But on the other hand, you know, it is flipping hard in the art world. Sometimes you feel very much alone. And interestingly enough, 2 weeks before he died, Joshua and I had really quite an intense conversation. And he understood totally where I was coming from. And it was really, in some ways, quite sort of, I don't know, it was quite sort of, I can't think of the word. You know, it was, we had a tremendous sort of support for each other. I can't really, in fact, as I'm talking about it now, it's just bringing a lump to my throat, thinking about it, really. You know, I mean, I know he felt alone, really, even though there was that sort of support. You know, he felt sort of somehow, maybe quite isolated. That was my feeling, anyway.
I used to worry, really, about where it was going, and about the fact that we couldn't help him financially, and actually it wasn't really... I mean, even if we'd had thousands of pounds, it wasn't really a very good idea to give it to him, because
no.
It wouldn't actually have helped him. And, I mean, the awful truth was that we didn't have the money to give him lots of money, but, I mean, we were conscious of his financial struggle, and conscious of... Well, that he was sticking his neck out, really, artistically, and what an incredibly courageous and lonely venture it was.
I think the loneliness is absolutely right.
I mean, now he's dead, I'm ashamed that, you know, I was quite hard with him with money. I was more hard-nosed and practical than, now he's dead, than I would have liked to have been. But at the time, you know, I just sort of, fucking, I'm just, you know, I'm in the bloody world, I've got to pay my rent. You're not getting that because I need the money for it. Joshua would go, but please do, you know, it'd be so easy and simple. And I wouldn't, but...
He wanted factual nonsense to be a power base that could take art into people's everyday lives and revolutionise it. The problem was that most people were completely unreceptive to this idea nowadays. No one really wants anyone to rock the boat or break the mould, because everyone has an established interest in things.
But at the time, he had no money. I mean, really no money. He used to go down to Brick Lane and he used to pick vegetables up off the street, because off the vegetable markets and stuff. He used to come back and cook these vegetables. They wouldn't sell on Brick Lane. But he loved it too. He sort of also loved it, but he was getting to the point where he'd had enough of it. He really had enough of it, and he was realising that, I think if you'd given him another couple of years or something, he would have got around that. The only thing that's slightly difficult about that is that he always said he was going to die young. He's rather like one of those people. He always used to say, I'm going to die young.
He called me to FN 4 days before he died. It was 3 o'clock in the morning. He had been suffering from the pressures of not being able to fulfill certain incredible promises he'd made to artists about exhibitions, things that he was going to sell. He was frustrated about lack of funding. He was short on money, and a lot of people who he had helped were perhaps not being as helpful to him as he had hoped. He had amassed a group of things that he'd collected from the streets with a friend of his called Tom. They'd been emptying out an old hospital of various medications that had been sort of stored up there in East London. And he'd collected them on the table. And I think he wanted me to see what he had there. I later found out that the things that he had on the table were things that he had taken the night he died. He had a bottle of ethanol nitrate that night on his table, and he told me he was going to drink it, and that's what he did. So. Mm-hmm.
He couldn't sleep at all, and he was taking all sorts of different things to try and make him go to sleep. But none of them really worked, and he used to sit... He had this bed, which I told you about, was up on top of this cupboard in his gallery where he used to sleep, but it had a skylight right above it. And quite often he wouldn't get to bed until it was light, and then he couldn't get to sleep then either, and he was sniffing ether to help him go to sleep. And I think he went out that night. He went to the Basquiat of all shows, I mean.
Again, it's another strange coincidence that it should have been an exhibition of Basquiat, who was another genius who died, sadly, very young.
On the night that Joshua died, I was actually at his parents' house. I saw his sister there, and she said, "I'm really worried about Joshua. He's acting very strange." And I said, "Well, you know, what's new?" And she said, "No, really, I'm very worried about him. I think he's getting quite disturbed."
The day my mobile was switched off, and I knew he called me, and I wasn't able to speak to him.
We were having dinner in St. John restaurant, and as I came out from the dinner, I saw him standing at the bar on his own, just drinking a pint of Guinness.
The next thing I know is on the Saturday is I get a phone at about 7 or 8 o'clock in the evening from Joshua's sister again, saying, "I really am worried about him now. Nobody's seen him for 3 or 4 days. Can you give me any phone numbers for any people he might know who live out of town?" I said to her, "Well, basically, he's probably just popped off somewhere. He's gone to a weekend party or something, you know, like he might do. He never really notifies people of his movements. And not to worry, I'm sure he'll turn up sooner or later." Which, of course, in a way, he did, because 3 hours later, I was phoned to say that he'd just been discovered dead in the gallery by his landlord.
We had a fax from Joshua's stepfather that nonsense is a part of life, and factual nonsense is dead, and Joshua is dead.
Of taking art into what he would call working class situations and being with the people, most people just thought was quite laughable. And to many people, he was a laughable character. A lot of people did laugh at him. And then as soon as he died, there was a huge sea change, which started to happen with the funeral. And I found it quite amusing that there were people at that funeral, the moment after it ended, who were in the pub with me, who had been really fucked off with him over the years and had quite a lot of animosity towards him, but were now kind of revering him, and as if he was some sort of cult figure or prophet. But it was all a bit too late, really, wasn't it?
You guy was amazing. I had to organise the funeral with his mother and various other people. And all these people suddenly come in and saying, oh, you know, I want to carry the coffin and paint the coffin and do this and stuff. And people who never paid any attention to him while he was alive, really. But you can't blame them. And a lot of people do blame them. And a lot of people blame them because Joshua's in danger of becoming a sort of patron saint of sort of losers.
The thing that made him unique was that he went and did his own thing, and he completely believed in it. He was completely convinced that it would work. And what really upset him was that no one else believed it. And no matter how hard he tried, no one would buy work from him, listen to him, take any notice of him. And people just derided him because he was willing to stand out in the crowd. And I think what the art world needs is a few romantic heroes. We could do with a few of them. We could do with a few less capitalist, money-making artists and a few more romantic heroes, that's for sure.